the barriers to developing outpatient or OPAT protocols are relatively complex. I think the first is developing an infrastructure at your hospital or health system. So if you don't have one already, you need some infrastructure to provide that. So that may mean that you have a relationship with home health and home pharmacy where they can provide the actual care at the house and they can provide the medication for the patient. Generally, that also involves having discharge planning and social work where they can get that patient everything that they need to involve that. Or in cases where you're just going to administer it in the emergency department, such as dalbavancin, and send them home, you need an ability to set up their follow-up and establish that follow-up for them. So if they have a skin and soft tissue infection or any other infection, they're going to go home. You want to make sure that they have adequate follow-up. And sometimes, you know, physicians, their main physician may not be in your health system. It's a little hard at 2 a.m. to get an appointment for them. So you need to be able to make sure that they have a backup and a way to come back and be evaluated, whether it's at your hospital or another facility. Or if they do see somebody in your healthcare system, you make sure you have that appointment available for them before outpatient therapy. So having that infrastructure of good follow-up, good discharge planning, and then possible home health if they're going home really is first of all paramount. Secondly, then you need administrative buy-in, and that includes two processes. One is administration, so they know that your goal is to get these patients home and not have them admitted. And number two, that's the physician and pharmacy side, which means that pharmacy and therapeutics, antibiotic subcommittee, whoever may be in charge of that, knows the right antibiotics, knows the subgroup to use them in, and is able to actually feel comfortable using them. So that's sort of the next stage. Very often, that's the stage where you see most of the conflict. Some facilities, particularly rural facilities, don't have the follow-up. That may be the case, but mostly in suburban and urban areas, you have discharge planning, all the appropriate follow-up and home health. It becomes a battle sort of between what physicians may want to do and what administration wants to do. So for example, some hospitals, they don't get a flat rate or a DRG for skin and soft tissue infections. They get paid for every hospital day. So their incentive is to admit that patient and keep them as long as possible. But you as a physician want to do what's best for that patient, and you may want to send them home on hospital day one or two or straight from the ED. So, you know, administration may push back a little bit. Or they may have an infusion center where they prefer to send the patient every day to the infusion center because that brings some revenue in for the healthcare system, even though that's difficult for the patient and they prefer to be at home. So that conflict between, you know, what's best for the patient and what the physician and pharmacy wants to do, what administration and finance wants to do, can be in conflict. And that's often where most of those battles occur. Overall, I think outpatient therapy for skin and soft tissue infections is sort of the future direction of where we're going with skin and soft tissue infections. I know that, you know, focusing on oral therapy, particularly with some of the generics like trimethoprim sulfa, doxycycline, was where we were about 15 years ago. And those are still the mainstay of treating skin and soft tissue infections as an outpatient. But there are a subset of patients, I would say let's call them in the gray zone, where they do have signs of systemic illness or they have a large lesion, greater than 75 centimeters squared, where routinely those patients are admitted. And we're now learning that many of those patients can transition to home either directly from the ED or shortly after admission. And getting used to that way of treating patients is different. And I think in the future, I'm looking forward to that being more stabilized. I know when the data came out on some of these long-acting lipoglycopeptides, and you really see a patient who has a large lesion, 75, 80 centimeters squared, and has a fever and has a white count, it feels weird to give them a single dose of an antibiotic and send them home. We're not used to that as physicians. We're used to writing, you know, a pen mark around the area of erythema. We're used to admitting them. We're used to seeing those that fever go away, that erythema regress. Then we send them home when we know they've gotten better. This is sort of that trust in giving a single dose of antibiotics, sending them out, and having them get better. And it's just uncomfortable. And we learned at my institution that for many of us, that felt very odd. It's a different way of practicing medicine, particularly with skin and soft tissue infections. So it took a little time for us to really say, okay, we have clinical trial data that suggests these patients are gonna be okay. Now we gotta feel okay with it at the bedside. And that took a little bit of time, and it's still a big work in progress for us. So I think we're moving forward, taking those patients who normally we would admit for a very short admission and transitioning them to outpatients, I think that's actually the big change. And it's just a comfort level for us as practitioners and as physicians. And I think that'll take some time. But I look forward to the growth of that and the expansion of other diseases around that. So looking at bacteremia and osteomyelitis and other areas where we can sort of support outpatient therapy quickly.